instrumental measurements. By now, we can almost confidently predict what you free electron do in a free space. And next stage will be what electron will do if we capture it within a box. The box can be a group of atoms, like a molecule with very narrow approximation, or a piece of semiconductor. And then they'll go to more complicated things. These models, like free space and box, are much easier than the simplest hydrogen atom, and we are pumping our philosophical and mathematical muscles on them. So today we will finally prove the statement that the center of the distribution will go on a straight line with constant velocity. And we need to get ready to the next chapter. And before that, just let's review what was going on before, and we'll go on in the future. So our schedule is very similar to last year. So on the meeting number 16, there will be presentations. And so it's quite close. So here is my first time in the career. I'm trying to show the grades. I hope showing the student IDs is enough to keep it secure so that you do not know student IDs of each other, right? And I just keep whatever you gave to each other. Some of these grades are a little too strict. I would give I would be happy to give more. So some of them are too favorable. Some works for problem homework two, problem three, just gave the answer, and the graders gave the full credit, probably because they want to give people the thing that they want to receive back. But it's fine. I don't have goal to ruin your career on one hand, and on another, you saw your errors and you know how to progress further. So presentations are scheduled for Friday. I hope you will have 9 presentations, but I didn't hear from Mai if she will join the meeting. But if she's missing, then it's a basic thing that we all are quite confident. And in the remaining 8, I was very surprised that there is one super responsible individual who has already prepared the slides for the Friday. It's like a wonder. I would never be so organized myself. Okay, so there is another homework which would be great to have on Wednesday. And it illustrates what we do right now. So you recognize this very simple practice of commutation when one swaps order of operators, and you see the connection with the material. The book to ways how to solve Schrödinger equation is just ways to refresh our minds. And normalization is always needed, because today we will practice finding expectations only from Heisenberg equation of motion, but more general, like in 90% one uses computation of observables out of wave functions. And this problem number 3 just helps everyone to recognize how important normalization is on one hand. And on another, if you hate normalization, it drives you to practice Heisenberg equation of motion. Number 4 is just reproducing whatever we saw a couple of lectures ago. And number 5 will be used in a week from now, starting next Monday. There will be like a couple of weeks based on the solution of this problem. So it, if you took differential equations, it will be just maybe 5-10 minutes. If you didn't, maybe half an hour, but it will let us analyze
science behind it for a couple of weeks. So it's quite an important thing. And it's a pretty, we will do it in class anyway in about 3 weeks. So it just gives you a chance to practice. And here is tentative schedule of points. So I don't know if you're curious or we are just as adults progress through material, but in case you're curious, here it is. So we did review German mining, right? With portrait of Gaussian. Now we are reviewing post stamps from Germany. One of their post stamps show the face of an old man who carries the flower and tears of petals, making a you know, like my one makes guess, loves me, loves me not. So in this post stamp, he tears off the petals and tells position momentum. You've heard the uncertainty principle, right? So which means there is no chance to measure simultaneously position and momentum. And Werner Heisenberg was the person who introduced this uncertainty, and therefore publishers of post stamps are making fun of him, telling that he doesn't know what is more possible to measure, positional momentum. So uncertainty of position times uncertainty of momentum is always bigger than some constant. Well, seriously, so what have we accomplished? I promised to myself to redo the slide in typing every year, but I failed for the last 10 years. Once I did it as a jazz music player, just by inspiration on the blackboard, then made a screenshot, and then I don't have energy to redo. So basically, what we have, there are ways to predict future, three by evolution curator, by short infinitesimal time evolution, and by solving Schrödinger equation, right? Schrödinger equation can be solved by time dependent, by solving time independent Schrödinger equation, then matching the eigenfunctions to initial condition, and then plugging this expansion coefficients into the series, which includes eigenfunctions, energies, which control how quickly phase is accumulating for each of them. And then expectation value of an observable can be found by practicing this sandwich. Wave function conjugated and iterator between them. Alternatively, what we covered last time, one can get the same answer, how the result of experiment evolves in time, by identifying which observable we need, commuting operator of this observable with operator of total energy, and then plugging it into the equation of motion for expectation value of operator. And then this one will look like one, or maybe sometimes a couple, several differential equations, ordinary, not infinite number of dimensions, but like one, two, three, and one gets the same answer. And it could be healthy to compare these two methods. Since both are allowed to live, it means there are benefits in each of them. And it's like a toolbox that we use depending on the situation. So criteria of comparison, number of degrees of freedom, because the smaller the number of degrees of freedom, the number of degrees of freedom, the easier is to solve equation by pen and paper. So smaller number of degrees of freedom is benefit. Mathematical challenge. In some sense, this class is a class of translation. Everything we do here, we translate between two languages. forcing that. We translate from language of common sense of analyzing little objects like molecules, atoms, and electrons, and math. And then when we solve mathematical problems, we convert that. And mathematical problems have to be solved either by ourselves or by someone we hire or by computer problems. So how strong is mathematical challenge? And then the third criterion is whether the equations are linear. So linear that independent variable never comes into powers, never example when one has derivative of function depending on the like derivative multiplied by power of the function, not of the independent variable, but the function. And then if there is non-linearity in differential equations, there are no theorems predicting their solutions. There are very little characteristics predicting whether the solution exists, whether it will converge or diverge if you change parameters. So if you were taking differential equations, you probably got sense of fear from your instructor to stay away from nonlinear equations. If you didn't, but you will deal with them, you will get this fear. It's healthy. So now, Schrödinger equation, it has infinite number of degrees of freedom because if we define a difference for a function, it's so many independent variables. Mathematical challenge is to diagonalize the Hamiltonian, and the major benefit of Schrödinger equation and the methodology one implies is one uses is that all equations are linear. So the Schrödinger equation has only derivatives of different powers and independent variable in different powers, but the wave function, unknown function, comes only in the first power, right? To the right, and as a first derivative of time to the left. So we never come to see wave function squared, at least in this class. In this mathematically, it's a really big benefit. It means even with many dimensions, one can always guarantee there will be a solution, and one can assign computer to solve it and expect that solution will be found. For Heisenberg equation of motion, it's very few degrees of freedom. It's only observable that we need, and maybe a couple of those that are conjugated to it. The equation that's typically ordinary differential equations, which are easy to solve. They're not partial, they're just ordinary, but they're not always linear. So sometimes, although it is simple equation, but it comes to nonlinear regimes, which is a headache of mathematicians. And maybe a rule of thumb would be to try Heisenberg equation of motion first because it's so easy. But as soon as one finds nonlinearity, then one needs to step back and try Schrödinger, something like that. So let's browse in space of ideas and mathematical models. So by now, we do have different methods which are on the x-axis. We may have different objects where we will apply our tools. And by now we have applied it only one situation, electron in a free space. But it's clear that we want molecules, we want chemical reactions, we want hydrogen atom, we want a lot that is related to real life, right? As long as our skills improve. And on the y-axis, we can put more and more complicated objects. And then on the z-axis that goes out of plane, we can include a thing that we will neglect until last week of the class, perturbation. So philosophically, you probably agree that perturbation is always there. Basically, suppose you are running wet chemistry reaction, you purified your product. And then you try to put it in NMR, chromatography, UVVs, what else you have. So how these instruments are working? The molecule itself is not shining light, is not changing magnetism of stuff around it. One needs to send there a probe, like a photon of light of certain frequency, and see how the molecule absorb or reflect or absorb and re-emit at certain frequency. And same with changing magnetic field. So all measurements, if one starts thinking of them, means perturbation. And one day we need to include. So by now, we will spend most of the course just studying properties of the model standalone and sometimes connecting them logically by human intuition to measurements. But in fact, if one wants literally to model measurement, one needs to include the process, how the molecule is irradiated by light, how this photon is taken, how it is released back. And this perturbation needs to be on the background of our thinking through the course, although we will not spend much of time for it. So it's like third dimension out of. And for methods, we have evolution, Schrodinger, and Heisenberg. Natural idea is to go to more and more materials and practical applications, but there will be few more points on the methods, because it's much easier to communicate the method to me than to have truly solved complicated problem. And as time allows, we will get more and more problems, but new methods will help us to be quicker. Sometimes there will be shortcomings. Okay, most seriously, let's start the and watch the time. I probably have something better than this ugly hand scratching. So we did prove last time through considering wave function propagating backwards in time with conjugation, right? That one, and then plugging it into a sandwich equation for predicting observable, that one can compile equation of motion for expectation of velocity. Now it's time to apply it. And if we are looking for center of the distribution for electron in free space, we looking for expectation value of position. Psi star x psi integrate and look how it goes over time. And instead of finding wave function, although we could do without learning new things, we already have this wave function evolving in time. Let's try this Heisenberg equation of motion. So we need to find commutation, right, between operator of interest, which is position, and total energy. What is the total energy of electron in free space? Correct. What is the potential energy in the free space? Anyone? Since we are not going to recording your glory of giving correct answer or shame of giving incorrect, can it be recorded? But you can just tell it to each other and to me. So what's potential energy of electron in a free space? You can show it by fingers. One positive answer, one correct answer. Anyone else? So one out of five did answer correctly. What does it mean, free space? With whom this electron is colliding? So who exerts potential energy onto electron? So what's up? Yes, two out of five. Anyone wants to show the correct answer? Yeah. So instead of letter O, you are showing fist to show zero. Is it common, right? Or it is just a okay. Zero. Clear? The potential energy is zero. No. Yes or no? Okay. So no comments are needed. In free space, electron has only kinetic energy because it is not attracted to anyone and it is not refused by anyone. So just go straight. So we need to find commutation between total energy and position, and instead of total, we put kinetic. Now, maybe you feel really comfortable with commutation of operators. I was not for many years, even after passing similar course. So here is the thing that makes our thinking, well, makes my thinking, I don't know about you, that prevents, that keeps my mental sanity. So when we are commuting two operators, one should always think that after this combination of operators, we have a function of independent variable phi. And then it is much easier to treat it logically. So the kinetic energy is it's another good question for a quiz, but I'm sure you know it, right? Through practice. Kinetic energy is momentum squared over two masses, and momentum is like some factors times first derivative. So kinetic energy is second derivative over space. And factors come like minus because of imaginary units, two masses and one constant. So second derivative and position. So to keep my mental sanity, I always thinking about function staying there. And then I practice this ha-ha equation, which means one do product in direct order and inverse order. And then this commutation, I could factor outside, second derivative, position, function, minus position, second derivative function, right? So it means that we do not violate our standard rules of calculus, we just follow them. And here, depending on the order of the variable and derivative, the result will be different. Can I go forward? Yeah, thank you. There will be a couple of ugly writing slides, but I think if you all understand each other, I just show type things. If questions arise, I'll start scratching things on the board. Okay. So, for the last term, we do nothing. Second derivative is second derivative. And for the first term, we can look on it as a like chain of few derivatives, one after another. And here is the, we should consider it as derivative of the product, right? So derivative of the x will be one, right? So we just remove it and we keep this pink phi and green derivative. And then here we keep the x changed and plug here just derivative, right? Now we have to apply second derivative to this box. And I think when I start practicing this derivatives, I should already remove this little hat to be, if anyone else watches and wants to criticize me, I declare head shouldn't be there at this at the slide. Okay, so derivative of phi is derivative of phi. And look here, in brackets, we change number of derivatives. Originally, we started with second, now it is first, right? And we didn't lie and didn't violate any rule. And here is the another derivative. Okay. Oh, we treat it as product, right? So first will be derivative of x times second sync unchanged, and then second will be x unchanged, and then second derivative apply to phi. And then we have total four terms. First derivative, x second derivative, x second derivative. And just by doing it carefully following definition, the last of the second derivative comes with a minus sign. So they are canceling, which is kind of natural. If it would be not operator but regular numbers, we should get zero. Things should cancel. But here are terms with plus sign. We can remove one and put two in here. And we see that by commuting x and second derivative, we are, as a result, we're getting the first derivative. So swapping operators is not innocent. We need to pay price for it. So price for swapping order of operators is first derivative. And which operator is that? Let me go back. You know the answer. If you are not immediately answering, it's only my fault of not asking it correctly. So let's scroll to our discussion about 10 minutes ago. In free space, there is no potential energy, right? There is only kinetic energy. Kinetic energy is momentum squared over two masses. And if you want differential form of this operator, we need to plug in something in place of momentum. What do we plug? What momentum is equal to? Some factors times what? Huh? Yeah, mass times velocity. But if we are thinking on the language of quantum operators, I'm coming to an idea of a quiz. let's remember, let's start course over. I'm joking. I'll just give a little refreshment. Generally, suppose our wave function is plane wave. Exponential, imaginary unit, value of momentum times value of position. Now, how to extract value of momentum out of this exponential function? So I need to write something because it's so that we do not lose each other in transit. Suppose our phi is E minus I P X. And to have right dimensions when we divide it by h bar. So which mathematical operation should I apply to this function so that as a result I would get this value p? How do I extract the function of x? How do I extract power of exponential from the exponential? Okay, so Joe suggests quantum log of phi, which then will be natural. Maybe one should use ln, right? Ln minus I p x h bar, and then if you want to receive p, we need to do ln phi divide by minus I x and multiply by h bar. And this will be p, right? Yeah, interesting. So anytime we see momentum, we need to replace it by log. Anytime we see momentum squared for kinetic energy, we need to replace it by log squared. Take logarithm of wave function twice, and then the equation will become nonlinear. The idea is correct, but maybe it's not comfortable for our purposes. But nothing is wrong. Any other way, how we can extract momentum, how you can extract this circled thing out of this exponential. Yes, thank you. So one can so or suggests to take derivative ddx of phi will be minus I p 1 over h bar phi, right? So by applying derivative to a function, we will get momentum. And we can redefine based from this derivation, we can redefine the momentum operator as derivative dx. And then we need to take care of the units. So if you want to keep only p, we may multiply it by I once again, then I and minus I will cancel. And then we need to multiply it by h bar, right? So now I'm asking once again, when we are making, when we are constructing kinetic energy operator, we need to plug there the momentum. What is the definition of momentum in quantum theory? Derivative of which order replaces momentum operator? First. Momentum is replaced by first order what? Derivative. Okay. So now you know what to answer in these circumstances. And this is maybe the first door between our common sense and quantum theory. Although we discussed longer than months, but practically as soon as you start thinking about momentum, not mass times velocity, but derivative over space, you are already quantum chemists and physical chemists at the same time. So it's a little bit non-usual way of thinking. Okay. So now we did commutation between Hamiltonian and position operator. We got the price for this swapping the first derivative. How should we interpret first derivative over position? If we see first derivative over position, we should immediately think of what? Yeah, velocity or momentum, right? So the commutation of position and Hamiltonian gives momentum. We are going to take care of the units and factors, but first derivative is nothing else, is momentum. I think I have it typed. So here is the literally what we got in this commutation. So first derivative, pink function that we can always remove. We kept it here only for our mental, at least for my mental sanity. Maybe you can do things without it. And then we have factors, Planck square, two masses minus. So here is the definition of momentum. So if you want to identify momentum operator here, we can, divide and multiply by imaginary unit and Planck, and then Planck constant, one of the Planck constants can be canceled. The factor two here and there is also canceled. And what else? And then we have Planck constant over mass, imaginary unit, momentum. So by commuting operator of total energy for free space and position, we are getting momentum operator. Everyone agrees? Okay, yeah, thank you. Now it's time to practice Heisenberg equation of motion. I don't know if you believe me that we are doing a shortcut through new concepts, memorization and concentration of thoughts. But the stuff that we learn, new things, definitions, and new concepts, we are doing it once. And then if we need to do it again and again, we will not spend time on learning new concepts. We will apply an actual mathematical problem that we need to solve. We even didn't arrive to it. We will arrive to it in like a couple of slides. And it will be like minuscule, like 20 seconds. So it's it looks a little non-logical and ridiculous that we spent 50 minutes for 20 minutes actual exercise, but everything except this 20 seconds, not many seconds, can be skipped when we apply this methodology to another problem. Okay, so commutation equals momentum. And here is the Heisenberg equation of motion. So if we need to find how position is changing over time, we need to put imaginary unit, Planck constant, and result of this commutation. So if we plug in this HIM, then H and H will cancel, I and I will cancel, and you'll get 1 over M, P. The result is not spectacular. It's very intuitively expected. So time derivative of the average expectation value of position equals velocity, momentum divided by mass. But we didn't borrow it from Mr. Newton, right? We derived it based on Schrodinger and Heisenberg equation. For this electron in free space, it will be correct. If we would take another problem, there is no guarantee that the result will be the same. There is a hope that it will be the same, but it's one needs to double check. It's a big joy that some quantum problems behave similar to classical. And some people call it principle of correspondence or something like that. But for some situations, quantum result is identical to classical, but it's not the rule. It's not always the case. But here, we mathematically derive that velocity is momentum divided by mass. But it's not just momentum velocity. It's expectation of it. Okay. And if you want to solve it, then we need to solve it as differential equation, integrate both left and right part over time. So on the left, one just integrates and gets average position over time, and there should be either left or right free constant, and here should be linear, just momentum times time, right? Momentum over mass times time, free constant, which would correspond to matching initial condition, and then position over time. So we are almost done, but how do we know what is the expectation value of momentum? Do we know if it is constant over time or it may change? In this situation, we already intuitively know, and it will be proved that momentum is not changing. But generally, it may change. And generally, we should double check that it is not changing over time. And it is a typical little difficulty of Heisenberg equation of motion. So it's often combined system of equation for few conjugated things. So last year I was out of time by this point, but now we have a few minutes. Maybe I can give a few more things because it will be logically connected. So B may want to practice Heisenberg equation of motion for expectation value of momentum, right? And now we need to plug in letter P instead of letter A into this ha-ha equation, right? You're following. So we do have kinetic energy. And now we, instead of putting derivative, we can just keep the letter P symbolically. So P squared factors outside, P in first power. And then we have P squared P minus P squared. Or I can even say PPP minus PPP. I don't have a speech defect, it's just math. Which will be zero, even if you are speaking in the language of operators. And there is even sometimes people formulated it as a theorem. So operator composed as the powers of single variable will always commute with this variable, something like that. But you see it naturally without any, without formulating it. Therefore, if we see this property, then Hamiltonian of free space and momentum commute, then time derivative of expectation value of momentum will be zero. And if you want to integrate this equation, if you integrate this integral of derivative, will be this unknown stuff. And then by doing integrations, we need a free term, right? So momentum as function of time will be equal to momentum at time zero, matching initial conditions. And then this one can be safely plugged back into previous equation. And then we did prove that the expectation value, position of the center of the wave packet of our planetary space moves linearly with constant velocity. And the velocity doesn't change. So at least in free space, quantum theory agrees well with classical theory. And I think by now we did prove our both hypothetical statements, that the center moves linearly with constant velocity and the width are constantly increasing. Bless you, bless you, bless you, right? So I believe we are done with a free space. So center moves linearly and the it becomes more and more less and less skinny, right? So done. I think we even saved a few minutes. Meeting is done. Everyone is welcome to disconnect. I'll stay here to answer questions if any. Do you intend to come to class on Wednesday? Yes? Okay. Josh, if you are connected, do you plan to come in class or connect online? Oh, you already left. Okay. If majority is here, we may do this little grading exercise in class, same as last time, right? I think grades will be better compared to if I do it myself. Okay. I'm going to disconnect. We don't want any questions to be recorded.